My name's William. I be a master gunner. And I serve no other than Sir Francis Drake, the finest sea captain and sailor that ever lived. Do you know, I must have sailed halfway round the world with him. The New World, to Spain and back to England again, all aboard the Golden Hind. But now, I'm serving on the good ship Revenge. That's Sir Francis Drake. He's a master amongst us men. You know, he doesn't refer to us as the crew. He refers to us as the ship's company. And he knows every single one of us men, the lads, by our names. And he even searches the ship. Every nook and cranny he looks to see that it's clean and that we've done our job. He's not a strutting peacock like those Spanish captains. No. He's an inspiration, that's what he is. He's an inspiration. It was through him that the world was opened up for trade for we English. No longer do the Spaniards rule the oceans, not with Drake on the high seas. You know, and he wasn't above listening to other men's ideas. When he come to shipbuilding, he realised that our old ships were too slow, too cumbersome in the water. So he got the finest of the English shipwrights to redesign the ships, make them lower, more streamlined, so they move faster through the water. He even changed the way we fought, our battle tactics. In the old days, you came alongside, fired a few shots at the enemy, then boarded their ship and fought it out. Terrible waste of life. The new tactics, well, our guns have got longer decks. You mount more guns. You can fire a full broadside into them. I tell you, there's not a man aboard our ship who wouldn't follow Sir Francis Drake to the very shores of hell. Now, the Spaniards knew of his reputation, and they were fearful of him. They hated him, they do, just because he outfoxed them at every turn. They called him a pirate. A pirate, indeed. Well, we have stopped the occasional Spanish ship and taken their treasure and their gold, but we never keep it for ourselves. We always give it to the Queen. It's for good Queen Bess, for the crown. Sir Francis Drake, he's the finest sailor, finest captain, and the finest gentleman you could ever wish to meet. Pirate. Pirate indeed. Now, I train our gunners. And I must admit, I do push them hard, but they're mighty fine gunners. But you must understand, there's more to this gunnery than meets the eye. You take our guns, this Saker here. We mount them on a low carriage with small wooden wheels. That means we can ram them right up to the hull, to the side of the ship, so the barrel pokes right the way out and get a good clear shot at the enemy. Now we rope our guns to the hull of the ship. So when they fire and pull back what we call the recoil, they don't shoot right the way across the other side of the ship. Now you just take a look at this gun. This is the ball he fires, a 5-pound iron ball. We can fire one of these out of these guns once every 10 minutes. We simply release the ropes, bring them in, load them, and then rope them back out again. Now the Spaniards, bless them, they have to climb outside many of their ships and load the guns from the other side. Their guns are mounted on great big wheels, like cartwheels, field guns they are really, and they can't bring them fully back into the ship. Many a brave Spanish sailor has been lost off the outside of his ship during a battle, simply blown clean off the side. I'm often asked how we managed to beat the Spanish Armada. Well, I reckon it all started long before the Armada actually sailed. I was with Drake on the raid on Cadiz. We captured a load of stores, you see. Wooden staves for barrels. This was seasoned oak, meant to be made into barrels that would store the food and the water for the Armada. Seasoned oak make watertight barrels. Well, we burnt the lot. The Armada had to sail with soft wooded barrels that leaked. Their food and their water went rotten very quickly, I can tell you. I remember the first time we saw the Armada. The first time we spied them was just off the coast of Cornwall. Their sails stretched halfway across the horizon. But we were going to use our local knowledge, you see. Sail betwixt them and the land. Get behind them. Their position on the sea was that like a crescent moon. They had their storeships behind, surrounded by their warships. The most powerful ships were at the front. They expected us to go straight and hit them on the nose. Well, we had other plans, you see. We split our forces. And me, on revenge with Drake, we went off towards the French side of them. I remember, as we came alongside, we opened the gun ports, ran out the loaded guns, and fired close. What a broadside. This is that new kind of fighting, those new battle tactics, where you give them a broadside, blow them out the water. Don't board them. Too many men lose their lives. Well, the Spaniards had never seen out like it. I tell you, the flame shot out yellow across the sea and the smoke billowed. You've never seen anything like it. Well, the Spaniards, they sent four of their fastest ships against us. They're called galleons. They have oars as well as sails, so they can manoeuvre in any kind of sea. As soon as they showed themselves, we simply hauled back on the sheets and disappeared for a while. Oh, we shadowed them. You see, we knew what they were up to. They were trying to land. So we came betwixt them and the land just off Portland Bill. We could move faster than them there because we used what's called a current, the Portland Race. And we stopped in getting into Weymouth Harbour, picking off any ships on the way. We did the same at the Isle of Wight. It was something to behold, I'll tell you. By this time, the Spanish had to make way across the Channel. They regrouped just off the coast of France, near a place called Dunkirk. We were behind them, of course, picking off any ships we could. But now they were too close together. We couldn't get in amongst them to give them our broadside. This new tactic of ours of simply blowing them out the water instead of attacking their ships and boarding them. So we had to stand off. But we Englishmen are cunning, you see. So we had eight of our ships, the small ones, you understand, cut out, filled and full of inflammable stuff, oil, gunpowder. We loaded their guns, put them low down in the hull. We set them on fire. Fire wouldn't show straight away, take a while to catch. And we sailed them out with skeleton crews. There was a nice current which took them straight towards this Spanish Armada. But the flames didn't show straight away. Our crews, they disembarked into their rowing boats and came back to us. Then we saw the flames flickering. They climbed up the masts and into the sails. Then one of the guns actually exploded. What a sheet of flame! The noise was like thunder. Well, I'll tell you, the Armada panicked. They must have cut their cable lines, losing their anchors. They sailed, smashing into each other. We'd done it. We broke them. We couldn't pursue. It was too dark. We simply watched the mayhem. But at first light, we gave chase. And we went straight into the heart of them. I ordered the gun ports open and the loaded guns ran out. We come that close to the hulls of the Spanish ships, you could almost touch them. And then we fired every gun abroadside. Our guns fired so hard, so fast, that the cannonballs smashed straight through the Spanish ships, going from one side of the hulls and out the other. And then we sailed straight past them, and Master Drake spun our new ships around, so streamlined, so true she came back, and we give them a broadside from the other guns. The noise was so incredible, bursting your eardrums through, the roar of the cannons, the popping of the muskets. It was like hell, it really was. And then, afterwards, when the smoke did clear, we saw the wreckage of the Spanish ships and we'd smashed to pieces. And we could see blood literally gushing out of the gun ports and the holes that we'd made. You could hear the noise of the wounded, the screaming, then the low moaning of the men who were dying. We'd heard that before. We knew what it was. I'll carry that sound to the grave, I reckon. But we couldn't tarry. We had to pursue what was left of the Armada. And we followed them up the east coast of England into Scottish waters. But then we had to leave them. We were short of ammunition and rations. I remember looking back and seeing those Spanish ladies sailing off into the distance. Many of them sailing to their doom.